السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسرني أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. We begin with the praise that belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send His peace, mercy and blessings upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon his beloved family members, upon his beloved companions and upon all of us and our family members. Ameen, Allahumma ameen. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless me in my speech, to remove the defects of my tongue, to make my task easy for me and bless me and grace me even more out of His grace and mercy so that all of you can understand my speech. I welcome all of you with the Islamic with the greetings of the Prophet alayhi salam, who said, and whenever people leave their homes, he said, greet them with marhaban bi wasiyati rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, meaning welcome and congratulations according to the testament of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and before we start, I praise Him, I thank Him, and I make a dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protects us and this beautiful center and inshallah this school, and may Allah give it increase in barakah and in ilm, and may it be a center that you and I both can benefit and make our akhirah out of it. Ameen, Allahumma ameen. And may we make it a means of pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and keep me away from riyah and kibr. Ameen, Allahumma ameen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses days for Himself, chooses people, chooses months, chooses time, chooses places. For example, He's chosen three great places: Makkah, Medina, Masjid al-Aqsa. And the darajat, the blessings are more when it comes to these places. Then Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen months. And in those months, He's chosen Ramadan to be one of the greatest month of blessings. Out of the 12 months, He's chosen 4 months that are sacred. And He's mentioned about the sacred months in the Quran. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of His people that He created, He's chosen people for His message. There are billions and billions that were created, but out of them, only 1,24,000 have been chosen as prophets. Out of the 1,24,000, only 300 and plus have become messengers. In those messengers, Allah has chosen 5 to be their ulul azam, the greatest of the great messengers: Nuh alayhi salam, Isa alayhi salam, Musa alayhi salam, Ibrahim alayhi salam, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi salam. So from this, we know that Allah chooses whom He wills to give blessings, to give barakah, to give whatever He wants. And from just like that, out of the angels, Allah has chosen the greatest of the great to be Jibreel alayhi salam, Israfil alayhi salam, Mikael alayhi salam. All these great messengers, all these great angels that Allah has chosen. In the same way, exactly in the same way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen days for Himself. For example, the day of Arafah, the days of Eid, the days that of Hajj. And one of the greatest, not just one of the greatest day that Allah chose for us is Yawmul Jum'ah, Friday. And today, inshallah, we would start a new session, the Fiqh of Jum'ah, the Fiqh of Jum'ah. And inshallah, we have 3 sessions to complete this. While I was sitting and preparing, I thought it would be 4. But what I've done is I've taken 3 sessions. Number one, the sunnah and the importance, the virtues of Jum'ah by itself before the sunnah, before the khutbah. Then I've taken an entire session, inshallah, on the khutbah and the etiquette of masjid for Jum'ah. Then I've taken salah and the remaining end of the Jum'ah, meaning the day that follows after Jum'ah. So 3 sessions. Number one, virtues, blessings, what to do, the sunnahs before salah, the khutbah, and then the salah. So three sessions inshallah. So try not missing them, because this is the day of Jum'ah, right, that we're discussing. So it's really, really important. Why? Because Allah's Messenger himself, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, has said that Jum'ah is blessed and chosen and honored by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Honored by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In fact, so much so, there is an entire surah on the day of Jum'ah. Surah Al-Jum'ah, when Allah says, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, idha nudiya lis-salati min yawm al-Jum'ah. Right, so Allah mentions about this salah, mentioned in this surah about this beautiful day. So with that, inshallah, let us start our first session. Our first session, that is the virtues, blessings, importance, things, innovated worships for this day, and the sunnah, or the fard things that you and I should do on this blessed day of Yawmul Jum'ah. And then inshallah, the next session will be on the khutbah. The first is, let's understand the root word of Jum'ah. Yawm is day. The word Yawm is day. Yawmul Jum'ah, the day of Friday. So Friday is Jum'ah. But Friday, the Jum'ah comes to the word Jama'ah. Jama'ah means together. Now there's another day, there's another name for Yawmul Qiyamah. Yawmul Qiyamah, another word, Yawmul Deen. Another word, Yawmul Hashr. Yawmul Hashr, the day of gathering. So what's the difference between Hashra and Jama'ah? You say Hashra, we'll be gathered, right? You say Yawmul Jum'ah, the day of gathering. What is the difference between Hashra and Jama'ah? Jama'ah comes from, the meaning is to gather, but to gather for a reason by yourself. To gather for a reason with your own will and intentions. You want to come. Hashara, to be driven to a place while being gathered. Like for example, flock or cattle. What's the shepherd who chases the cattle or who brings the cattle to the place? What is he doing? He's trying to gather all the sheep together. That is not Jama'ah, that is Hashara. So on the day of judgment, when you and I will be resurrected from the graves, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't call that day as Yawmul Jum'ah. Allah calls it day Yawmul Hashar. Meaning you and I will be gathered like flock of sheep, like cattle, there on the day of resurrection to be accounted on that place. So Jama'ah is to gather for a reason and by yourself. Hashara is to be gathered at a place while being driven by somebody else. This is the difference between Jama'ah and Hashara. So we don't call the day of Friday as being driven. Nobody's driving you to the masjid, right? Everybody, you come with your own will and intention. That's number one. Second is, when does Friday start? 12 noon, 12 midnight? No, it doesn't start. A lot of people ask me a question saying that, brother, can we pray, can we read Surah Al-Kahf on Friday night? So I says yes. I say yes, you can pray on Friday night. But that Friday night is not our Friday night after Maghrib. It's Thursday night. So get that right. Friday starts on Thursday Maghrib. And Friday ends on Friday Maghrib. So with the start of Maghrib Salah on Thursday, your Jumu'ah starts. And the start of Maghrib on Friday, your Jumu'ah ends. So this is the time, 24 hours, from Maghrib to Maghrib. So now a question, what if I want to do, will I get the same reward of Jumu'ah on Thursday night? Yes, it's a part of Jumu'ah. So whatever is Thursday night, it's a part of Jumu'ah. And thank Allah that movies don't release on Thursday night. Right? They release on Friday night, which is technically not a Jumu'ah. Alhamdulillah, right? MashaAllah. So we have the most beautiful day and then we spoil it. So Friday starts with Thursday Maghrib and ends with Friday Maghrib. Now let's take something about this beautiful day. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that This nation of mine was blessed with this day. For verily, we came at the last. We are the last nations, but we will be accounted first. We have been guided to Jum'ah, and we will enter Jannah first. Subhanallah. So there's no long wait. We are the last ummah, but we will be resurrected first, and we will enter Jannah first. So what is the meaning of we will be guided to Jum'ah? Or rather, we have been guided to Jum'ah. This means that the previous nations, the Bani Israel, the Jews, when they came, and when Musa alayhi salam, they wanted a day of for religion, for just, they chose Saturday. They chose the day of Sabbath, Saturday. And that's why on the day of Sabbath, killing was not allowed. Fishing was not allowed. Only you had to spend the entire day in ibadah, in worship. And those who came out and fished, what did Allah do? Allah says in the Quran, Allah made them qiradatun. Allah made them monkeys. Subhanallah. Why? Because they broke the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alhamdulillah, this nation Allah has blessed and Allah has given a lot of leniency. We don't have to sit from Maghrib to Maghrib in ibadah. All we have to do is pray the 5 times salah. Yes, come to the masjid on Friday for the khutbah. Khutbah is a part of the Friday Jum'ah. Right? Inshallah, when you come to that, we'll know how important the khutbah is. So now, how are we guided? The Jews came first and they took Saturday as their day of ibadah, Sabbath. The Christians, the Nasara, came second. And they chose, because they were after the Jews, they chose the day after Saturday, and they chose Sunday. While when the Muslims came, technically we should have chosen Monday, and they wanted us to choose Monday. When we chose Friday, they were very jealous, because they knew Friday was the truth. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided us to having Friday as our day of congregation, our day of Jumu'ah, our day of Ibadah, and our day of blessings. And this is why Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that Friday is the best day of the week. Friday is the best day of the week. I'll tell you a hadith that Allah's Messenger says, even so much so that the two Eids put together can't match the Friday that we get every week. Subhanallah. That is how important Yawm al-Jum'ah is. And you and I as Muslims should take advantage of Jum'ah. So Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that it is on a Friday that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala compelled and He created the creation. Created the creation. And on Friday, the Prophet Adam was created and he was expelled from Jannah. And he was thrown out from Jannah. And it was Friday that he was asked, that he was given forgiveness. And it was Friday that the day of resurrection will be started. The day of Qiyamah will start on a Friday. And it will be Friday that people, the day of judgment will be on a Friday. So obviously on Friday itself that we will enter Jannah. Next, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that on this day, on this Yawm al-Jum'ah, on Friday, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam alayhi salam. But when He created Adam, He took the sand from all the parts of the globe, all the parts of the earth, and He mixed it and He created Adam. And Allah's Messenger says, this is why that we get different colors of people, white, wheatish, black, really, really white. So this is why, this is the reason that you and I have different colors, so that we may recognize the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that it was on a Friday that we did this. Next, Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu narrated that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that it is a Friday. It is on the Friday that the day of judgment will be started, that the Yawm al-Qiyamah will start. And it is this same day, that day of judgment, which happens on a Friday, that the mountains fear, the angels fear, the jinns fear, everybody fear the day of judgment. So brothers and sisters, why did I get this hadith in this talk? That the day of judgment will be on a Friday, and it is the day of judgment that everybody fears. Understand, when you and I are gathered on Yawm al-Jum'ah, It is something that you and I should reflect and look back, that you and I will be gathered on a day like this, but not for salah before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not to pray our salah, but to give our account for salah. Not to make dhikr of Allah, not to read the Quran, but how much we have read the Quran. This is the day that you and I will be accounted for. And it's very, very important that you and I reflect that upon this day. The next heading is the virtues of Yawmul Jum'ah. Since we started late today, I've skipped the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, inshallah, next Sunday we'll come back to the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The virtues of Jum'ah. The first, I just said this, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgave, or Adam alayhi salam repented on Friday and Allah forgave him on Friday. Meaning, Friday is a special day that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive people. Will forgive people. Next, the famous verse of the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Ma'idah, Surah number 5 and Ayah number 3, that today, this day, I have perfected your religion, completed my favor upon you, and chose for you Islam as your deen. So, a man came to Umar ibn Khattab and said that if this verse was revealed to us, we would have taken that day as a day of Eid. And Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu looks at this man and says, by Allah, I know which day and where it was revealed. It was the day of Arafah where this verse was revealed, and for a fact, I know that it was Friday. Subhanallah. So when you wanted to have a day of Eid, Allah already chose to make the day of Eid for this ayat. So one of the things that Allah completes His favor and completed this deen was on a Friday. The ayat of Surah Ma'idah, Surah number 5 and ayah number 3. Next, Allah's Messenger says, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that Friday is the master of all days and the most virtuous, most greatest day in the sight of Allah. And it is greater than the two Eids, Eid al-Fitr and Eid al-Adha. From this we understand that Friday is the greatest day of our life. Next, Abdullah ibn Amr radiallahu anhu said, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, that one of the greatest virtues of dying on a Friday, he says, no Muslim dies on a Friday. No Muslim dies on a Friday except that he will be saved from the punishment of the grave. Subhanallah. So if you and I die on a Friday, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that he will be forgiven, or rather not punished in the grave. And we know how severe the punishment of the grave is of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Next, the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, disapproved offering salah when it is really hot, when the sun is right above, really, really hot. He disapproved on any other day except Jum'ah. So when it is Jum'ah, you're allowed to pray. You're allowed to pray at times when you can't pray. So this is again one of the significance of Yawmul Jum'ah, that Allah has preferred and loved it. Next, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that when a person does five things, when a person does five things in one day and he dies after that, if he does these five things, he is guaranteed Jannah. Subhanallah. So if you and I can take these five things in one day, he is guaranteed Jannah. What are they? He says, number one, in the same day if you visit the sick, in the same day if you get a funeral to attend, in the same day if you are fasting, and in the same day if it's a Jum'ah, and in the same day if you free a slave, then the person will have Jannah. So now you say, brothers, how can we fast on a Jum'ah? Yes, fine, I'll make somebody sick and go and visit him, right? I can kill somebody and go and attend his funeral prayer. But how do we fast on Jum'ah when Allah's Messenger has said it's a day of Eid? Now this is not, fasting on the day of Friday is not singling out only Friday. So you can't take only Fridays and fast. That is not allowed. I'll tell you, I'll come to that point later. This is when Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the best fasting is like the fasting of Dawood alayhi salam. How did Dawood alayhi salam fast? Every alternate days. So if you are in a habit of fasting every alternate days and you fast on a Jummah, alhamdulillah. If you're fasting on a Thursday and Friday, alhamdulillah. If you're fasting on a Friday and Saturday, alhamdulillah. But singling out Friday, not allowed. Not allowed. So from this we understand, if you get Friday as a day of fasting and you visit the sick, a sick person, you attend the funeral prayer, subhanallah, and so on, then you get Jannah. Now a common question, how do we free a slave in this time? How do we free a slave in this time? Anybody knows the hadith? Subhanallah. When you read 10 times, La ilaha illallahu wahdahu la sharika lahu lahul mulku wa lahul hamd wa huwa ala kulli shayin qadir. 10 times in the morning and 10 times in the night, you have freed a slave from the progeny of Ismail alayhi salam. Subhanallah. What does it mean from the progeny of Ismail alayhi salam? Our nation. Right? We are from Ismail alayhi salam. So Allah's Messenger says that the one who reads 10 times, how much time will it take? Hardly 2 minutes, 3 minutes. Subhanallah. During Rasulullah's time, they spent money. They had to buy slaves. Today, we have to only think of buying slaves and then we can buy slaves. Subhanallah. That's how easy Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made our religion. So 10 times in the morning, 10 times in the evening. Make it a habit by Allah. Make it after Fajr and just before Maghrib. Subhanallah. That's the best time. By Allah, it's the best time. Right? And on the third session of this class, we will talk about an hour that is on Yawm al-Jum'ah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed. And when that hour comes or what should we do in that hour, inshallah we'll deal with that. So Allah's Messenger says five things. So now let's go back to this hadith and think. Visiting a sick, attending a funeral, fasting, Jum'ah. Meaning, when can you do this? Only on a Friday. You can't attend Jummah on a Saturday or a Thursday. You can do four things. You can fast on a Thursday. You can attend somebody's funeral on a Thursday. You can visit the sick on a Thursday. And you can free a slave on Thursday. But can you get Jummah on a Thursday? No, you can't. So subhanallah, Friday is the day that you are guaranteed Jannah. So if you come across somebody who's sick on a Friday, you come across somebody who passed away on a Friday, make sure that you do it. Alright, inshallah. Next, you and I should not single out any act of worship on a Friday. For example, I know personally a lot of people who say, I want to pray Qiyamul Layl only on Friday. Technically, it's allowed, no problem. But what you're doing something that Rasulullah didn't do. Rasulullah did Qiyamul Layl every single day. So now if you think that I want to do only on Friday, not allowed. It's not, the ulama say, it's not recommended, it's a bid'ah, right? So if you want to do something, do it on a consistent basis. Don't pick out Friday. Friday, good day, I don't work on Friday. I don't do business on Friday. All these things are not allowed. You can do anything, subhanAllah. We are not the qawm of Bani Israel that Allah has put so many clauses and prohibitions, right? So Allah has let us to do anything. So don't customize. In fact, there's a hadith from Abu Huraira radiallahu anh that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, do not single out the nights of Friday. Alright, listen. Do not single out the nights of Friday amongst the nights for prayer. Subhanallah. So I just spoke about Qiyamul Layl. Allah's Messenger says, do not single out the nights of Friday for the nights of prayer, and do not single out the days of Friday for days of fasting. So from this we understand, if you want to fast once in a week, that can't be Friday. That can either be what? Mondays or Thursdays. That's the sunnah of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Next, giving charity. Just like when you give charity in Ramadan and it increases, your reward increases, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, the one who gives charity, and in fact a lot of ulama back it up, saying the one who gives charity on Friday, his reward is also multiplied more times. And this is again the virtues of Friday. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises by this day. Allah promises by the sun, by the moon, by so many things. And in this surah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالسَّمَاءِ ذَاتِ الْبُرُوجِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْمَوْعُودِ وَالشَّاهِدِ الْمَشْهُودِ. And by the witness day, and what is being witnessed. The witness day is Friday. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's messenger, and the ulama say, that the promised day is Friday. Not the witness day, the promised day is Friday. Next comes the blessed hour on Friday. The blessed hour on Friday. And there are two hadith, and both of them are sahih. Both of them are correct. But I won't do it in today's session, I'll do it in session number 3 in detail, inshallah, because one of them is after salah. One hadith is, the first hadith is before salah, the second hadith is after salah. So it doesn't come in our session today. Alright. Another beautiful reward or virtues of Friday is, Friday is the day, subhanallah, that you and I actually, subhanallah, actually, we see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We will see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of judgment. Why? Because it's a Friday. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala again chose a Friday to be blessed, that you and I can actually see Rabbul Jalali wal Ikram, subhanallah. The Rabb of you and me, we can see on Friday. Allah says, وَجُوهٍ يَوْمَ عِذٍ نَاظِرَةٍ, that وُجُوحَةً يَوْمَ عِذٍ نَاظِرَةٍ, that some faces on that day will be radiant and delighted with goodness, looking at their Lord, looking at their Lord. إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٍ, looking at their Lord. So this is the same day that you and I get a chance to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Next, we come to some actions, some deeds that you and I need to perform on Yawmul Jumu'ah, especially on Jumu'ah, and more on other days, yes, but more on Jumu'ah. Number one, what should you and I do? We should increase our darood on Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam. We should increase darood as much as you can. There are two ways to read darood. Both are authentic and both are sahih. The best khair is Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka hamidu majid. Allahumma barik ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka hamidu majid. This is one darood. The second is Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama Allahumma salli ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa barik wa sallam. This is the smaller darood. Both of them are sahih, both of them can be read. And the number should be increased on Friday. The number of times that you and I read darood should be increased on Friday. Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that on the day of judgment, those who recite darood more will be closest to me. And I'll tell you about the reciting on Friday, another hadith. But if you come to reading darood, when you hear the name of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, is it sunnah, is it nawafil, or is it fard to say the darood? It's fard. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands in the Quran. He says, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu. Surah Ahzab, surah number 33, ayah number 56. Allah says, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu. O you who believe. Inna Allah wa malaikatahu yusalluna 'alan nabi. Allah and his angels send darood, send barakah, send blessings upon Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, O you who believe, sallu 'alayhi wa sallimu taslima. Recite, read and send darood, send blessings upon Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this is a compulsion on us to pray darood. Now Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that, in fact, Ibn Qayyum wrote a hadith that Allah's Messenger said, make many prayers for me on the day of Friday. Make many prayers, meaning send extra darood on the day of Friday and on the night of Friday. Now, what is this night? Friday night or Thursday night? Th- Thursday night, right? Not Friday night. Maghrib after Friday, the Friday night Maghrib will not be considered as Jummah, will be considered as Saturday in Islam. Why? Because we start our day technically after Maghrib, and our day ends just when the Maghrib starts, the sunset. So Allah's Messenger says, send many, many darood or blessings upon me on the day of Friday and on the night of Friday. So meaning, why I didn't start with Fajr of Friday? Because Thursday Maghrib, your Friday starts. So try to, as much as you can, read Allahumma salli ala Muhammad, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad, wa ala Ali Muhammad, and so on. Next, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that the Messenger of Allah is the leader of mankind, right? And Friday is the best day of the week. Prayers for him during that day, Ibn Qayyum rahimahullah said this, prayers for this, for him on this day is a privilege and a blessing that he deserves. He deserves. So out of love for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you and I both need to recite the Darood as much as we can. Next hadith, nothing to do with Friday, but Allah's Messenger was asked when he said, send Darood upon me abundantly. Send Darood upon me abundantly. For your Darood comes to me. Your Darood comes to me. So the Sahaba said, Ya Rasulullah, will you receive our Darood when you are in the grave? Allah's Messenger responded saying that Allah has prohibited, yani Allah has prohibited or forbidden the earth to consume the bodies of the prophets. So from this we understand that the prophets' bodies is not consumed. And there are many, many proofs to show that Allah's Messenger, yani, responds to our Darood in his grave. Next, virtues of reciting Surah Al-Kahf on Surah Al-Kahf on Friday. There's another hadith which says that to memorize the first 10 ayats or the last 10 ayats of Surah Al-Kahf. This has nothing to do with Friday though. This has something to do with Dajjal, the one who memorized the first 10 ayats and recites them frequently. He will be safe from Dajjal. But this has nothing to do with Friday. The hadith, the Sahih hadith that has something to do with Friday is reading Surah Al-Kahf. And Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that the one who reads Surah Al-Kahf, there will be a nur, a light that Allah will give him from one Friday to the other Friday. There will be a light, a nur from one Friday to the other Friday. And then Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that the Friday is from the sunset of Thursday until the Jummah ends the sunset of Friday. So from this we understand that whatever we have spoken is the truth. Another hadith regarding Surah Al-Kahf is Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever recites Surah Al-Kahf in the manner it was revealed, as it was revealed, meaning with correct tajweed, right, just not zipping through, in the manner it was revealed, then it will serve him as a light for him on the day of judgment. Subhanallah. Number one hadith, the one who reads Surah Al-Kahf, that he will be given a nur, a light from this Friday to the other Friday. Another hadith, Allah's Messenger says, the one who recites Surah Al-Kahf, as if to say, the way it was revealed, meaning slow with tajweed, with correcting, yani no mistakes, then it will serve him as a light on the day of judgment. Next, we come to yani some innovated beliefs, right? Innovated beliefs on Friday. A lot of us think that Friday, alhamdulillah, is blessed, so there are more things that you and I should do. And we go out of the way. For example, we tend to read the Quran only on Fridays. Picking out, like Allah's Messenger said, picking out the night of Friday for a particular act of worship is not allowed. Picking out just the days of Friday and saying, I would do it only on Friday, not allowed. So you and I should not say, okay, I want to read only the Quran. Yes, Allah's Messenger has given a Sahih hadith regarding Surah Al-Kahf it's there. But regarding reading the Quran only on Fridays, not allowed. Quran should be what? A guide throughout the whole week, not only on Fridays. Just because Allah has blessed Friday doesn't mean that you and I pick out certain things on Friday. This is what we try to say. Next. Remembrance, dhikr on Friday should be increased. Remember, this is not... See, I'm telling you, I'll repeat it again. Certain things should be increased on Friday, not just done on Friday. I'll repeat that again. Right? If you're dhikr, if you're praying dhikr, it should not be done only on Fridays. It should be increased on Friday. Charity should be increased on Friday. Darood should be increased on Friday. Don't just pick Friday for these things. You and I should have a habit of reciting these things and doing it more often. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Allah's Messenger says, increase zikr on Friday. And there are many, many hadith that Allah's Messenger says about zikr, that it is like a person who is dead and alive. The one who remembers Allah is like the person who is living. And the one who forgets Allah is like the person who is dead. And in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Hashar, Surah number 59 and ayah number 19, وَلَا تَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ نَسُوا اللَّهَ فَأَنْسَاهُمْ. Don't be like those who forgot Allah. Right? Allah will make you forget your own self. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ. And they are surely the people who are fasiqun. Next, virtues of memorizing and reciting the Quran on Friday. Right? Now again, doesn't mean that you memorize one Friday and then leave the Quran and next ayat on next Friday. Right? Try, inshallah, to memorize the Quran every single week. Right? If you can get a teacher, and recite to him every Friday, subhanAllah, that's great. So the whole week, memorize, come to him once in a week, recite to him. Reciting the Quran is great reward, and Friday, alhamdulillah, even more great. Next, making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is of great importance. Is of great importance on Fridays. Now, like I mentioned to you, Friday is a day that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us special time. Right? Now I'll tell you four ways, four times that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses us on Friday. Two are common for all the other days and two are special for Friday. Go back to the hadith of tahajjud. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Allah comes down on the last third of the night and He calls out, who is there to ask forgiveness? Number one. Who is there to ask what he wants that I'll give? Who is there to make a request that I'll fulfill his request? This happens every single night. Correct? So this happens on Friday as well. So Friday, number one, you get the time of tahajjud, Thursday night, alhamdulillah. Second, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's Messenger says that at the time in the afternoon, midday, just before dhuhr, again, this is something that you and I should do. Allah calls out, or rather puts out his hand and says, who is there to ask me and I will bless. Now this happens every single day again, just before dhuhr, the time just before dhuhr, at the time of zawal. You and I should take time off, at least 5 minutes, and make dua. Make a lot of dua in this time. And Allah will bless us and accept us. Then comes the two occasions of Jummah. Number one, just before Maghrib. Number two, from the time the khutbah starts up until the prayer ends. So these are all four times that Allah has given us more time to make dua on Friday. Other days, Allah has told these two times are great. But Fridays, Allah Himself has increased the number of times. SubhanAllah. Meaning, it shows that you and I should increase our connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and increase our dua that we make to Him. Then comes seeking forgiveness. Go back to the opening hadith. Right? Adam alayhi salam committed a mistake and he asked Allah to forgive. Which day did Allah forgive him? Friday. So from this we understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is even more merciful on the day of Friday. Because He loves it. He's increased the blessings, He increased the reward, He's increased everything on Friday. So from this, you and I should ask forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, especially more on Fridays. Next, big blunder that you and I do is we get Yawmul Jummah, we get Friday, and we pray, we make sure wherever we are, whatever profession we are doing, whatever business we are doing, we make sure that we attend the Jummah Salah. We make sure that we attend the Jummah Salah. But do you know something? That is not the greatest Salah of the day. The Fajr of Friday is the greatest Salah of the whole week. The Fajr of Friday is the greatest Salah of the whole week. So if you and I miss the Salah of Fajr, and then we do everything to get the Jummah prayer, we've still not put the best effort. Why? Because we've not got the best thing of the day of Friday. Now again, come back to Fajr. Fajr is every single day. Yes? Why did Allah choose Fajr of Friday to be the best Salah of the whole week? Subhanallah. Number one, toughest Salah to get? Yes or no? Toughest Salah to get. Number two, on the best day. Toughest Salah on the best day becomes the greatest Salah of your week. Simple. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's Messenger says that Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu narrated that the best Salah for the week is Salatul, yani the Fajr of Friday. And you and I should try our best to get it, especially the ladies as well. You know, just, you don't have to come to the masjid, but make sure that you wake your family up and at least get Salah of Fajr. And the two surahs that Allah's Messenger recited, what? Sajda and Insan. We're not talking about Salat, the Jummah Salah, the Fajr Salah. What are the two surahs that Allah's Messenger recited? Surah Sajda talks about what? Creation. The first ayats talk about what? Creation. Allah created the heavens and the earth in 6 days. Then Allah rose up. Then talks about so many things. Then, what's an ayat that who can pull me? Come on. They forsake their beds and they stand up in prayer except a little. Right? Illa qalila. They forsake their beds. I'm forgetting that ayat. They leave their beds and they stand. Surah Sajda. They leave their beds and they get up and pray. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Surah Sajda, which you and I pray the first rakah of Friday, Fard. But Allah says, they leave their beds. They forsake their sleep and they get up in prayer. Subhanallah. The first thing that Allah mentions in Surah Sajda, creation and getting up to pray. Then what does Allah talk about the next? In the next rakah. And you have a Sajda there. In that same surah, you have a Sajda. Every Friday, people are making Sajda in the first rakat. Then Allah talks about Surah Al-Insan. What does Insan talk about? The day of judgment. Subhanallah. So Allah is trying to give you the creation and the end in a nutshell of Surah Al-Jum'ah. In the fard of the Fajr of Surah Al-Jum'ah. This was something that you and I should do on Jummah. And then comes the most important thing that a Muslim does on Jummah. What? To bathe. So other days we don't bathe, right? Dirty buggers, man. Right? Allahu Akbar. No. Alhamdulillah. As Muslims, you know, there was a question posed to a scholar. He says, why do Muslims have a bath only on Friday? He says, no, Muslims don't have a bath only on Friday. Muslims have a bath every single day. Friday is special and sometimes it was made compulsory to have a bath on Friday. Right? Made compulsory, then it was given any discount. So then he says, no, but Muslims are still dirty. He says, then the speaker said, I'll show you who's more dirty. Alright? You tell me, who is more clean? The man who washes his feet 5 times a day or the man who has a bath once in a day? You and I, subhanAllah, wash our feet also 5 times in a day. Right? With wudu. So just imagine how much hygiene that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given in our life. Now, the history of having a bath which was made compulsory was during the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there was a masjid that was built. There was a masjid that was built on the outskirts, and it was very small. And once Allah's Messenger on a Friday came to this place, and during the Sahaba's time, they were not rich. They were not rich, and they did not have many, many clothes. They didn't have a wardrobe like us, right? So they had to wear one shawl or towel or even a garment, with a single garment. Some people had two, some people had one, and they would come to Rasulullah and say, "Ya Rasulullah, which one should I cover for salah? My upper body or my lower body?" SubhanAllah. That's how poor the Muslims were. The Messenger of Allah would say, "Cover your lower body and let your shoulders..." For such people, shoulders can be seen. Right? Not you remove the shirt and say, "Oh man, good muscles," right? That's different. You and I should cover our shoulders in salah. That's very, very important. Now you say, what about Hajj? Exceptions. Right? When we tire, we can leave one shoulder open, whatever. Right? Even then, it's recommended that you cover your entire body. So Sahabas were really, really poor, and they didn't have money, they didn't have many, many clothes. So they would go out, and you should know the Sahabas worked with their hands. They would, you know, cut trees and sell wood, or they were shepherds, they would be farmers. Literally they would sweat. And they would come in and pray in this masjid many, many, many times. Rasulullah once, what happened, he came to a Jummah, and he entered this masjid, SubhanAllah, lo and behold, it was stinking. Rasulullah felt the smell, and he says, "Allahu Akbar, this is disgusting. Your masjid is smelling." And then he came out, he says, "Friday is wajib for you to have a bath, at least Friday." Right? In a desert, you never got water. Understand, they had problems with water, so they couldn't really have a bath every single day. So he says, "Friday is wajib." Then Allah's Messenger said that Muslims won battles and they became rich. And they now started buying more clothes. So then every time they would come in on Friday, and they would change in to new clothes, and they would come in. And that's when Allah's Messenger says, now it is not wajib, it is sunnah. If you want to have a bath, alhamdulillah. Wadu is wajib, but it's khair. It's much, much, much better that you have a bath on Friday. So Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that it's khair, and it's really, really important. And one of the greatest rewards that Allah's Messenger mentions is forgiveness of all our sins. But that hadith has five things. The first is to have a bath, to have a ghusl. The second is to apply perfume. The third is to come to the masjid. The fourth is to listen attentively. The fifth is to sit close to the imam. When somebody does these five things, then there's a reward for it. And I'll tell you that reward later on. So let's come to the... So Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, on the day of Friday, Muslims should bathe completely, and their head, the hair of the head and the rest of the body should be thoroughly washed. And they should do miswak. It is recommended that you do miswak on Friday. Really, really important. Next, if a man does not have any perfume in his house, then he should try to obtain one. SubhanAllah. If you don't have oil, or if you don't have perfume, you should try to obtain one for Fridays. So if you have a small bottle, you can't really afford an expensive perfume, then any perfume would do. But if you can't afford a perfume at all, then you should at least buy one small bottle and keep it only for Fridays. Right? Use that on Friday, because Allah's Messenger has said five things. Number one, ghusl. Number two, perfume. Number three, walk. Number four, listen attentively. And number five, sit close to the imam. So then Allah's Messenger, Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu, said that taking a bath on Friday was compulsory for every Muslim who attained the age of puberty. And then Allah's Messenger relaxed this order. However, miswak and applying perfume was made desirable, was highly, highly recommended. Then Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Muhammad ibn Yahya reported that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if somebody has two garments, then he should obtain the third and keep the third for Friday. SubhanAllah. So this is something really important. Now if you have a wardrobe, now something, just imagine, you go back today and you have about, say, 12 or 15 dresses or whatever, right? Sisters, I'm not talking about you. You must be having 15,000, right? So if you have, I'm talking about poor Muslims like us men, right? You know, the best part is when you move into your room with your wife, you have four cupboards, you say, okay, two are yours, two are mine. She says, fine. But you end up having half. Not even one, half. And then suddenly when you open it, you say, what happened to my clothes? No, they're outside. Or they're in the suitcase. All four have been taken away. And then she says, I don't have clothes only. Right? Allahu Akbar. MashaAllah. Allahu Akbar. So Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that if you have two garments, then you should obtain another and keep that for Friday. What does it show? Subhanallah, that means it shows that you should be prepared for Friday. The ulama say that on a Thursday night, you should be happy and you should prepare yourself, it's Friday. You should get ready, cut your nails, trim your mush, whatever you have to do on a Friday. Prepare yourself that it's a Friday. It's make it feel different. Why did Allah's Messenger say, if you have two garments, take a third and keep it for Friday? Why? It makes you feel different, right? To imagine you have three garments and you have kept one for Friday. And every Friday you wear that. And subhanAllah, when you come out, you say, subhanAllah, this is my Friday dress. Right? Not like a Superman dress. But it's a Friday dress, subhanAllah, that makes you special. So, Allah's Messenger says that keep this work, keep this dress for Friday and keep others for daily use. The hadith, subhanAllah. So if you go and segregate your wardrobe today and you say, okay, this is for Friday, you're actually doing a sunnah. SubhanAllah, you're actually doing a sunnah today. Right? InshaAllah. So now sisters, your 15,000 clothes, how many you want to keep? Right, 12,000 for normal days. Last, and I'll end my hadith with this, and I'll end my first session with this beautiful hadith. Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Salman al-Farsi reported from Allah's Messenger, he says, whoever takes a ghusl, a bath on Friday, like the bath of janabah. So now, ghusl on Friday is different. You might have a shower head to toe on every single day, Monday to Sunday, whatever. But Fridays, choose to do your ghusl like the bath of a janabah, meaning you're impure. So you have to be pure. Cleanse himself as much, puts oil or puts perfume. So perfume. And then proceeds to the prayer. Does not separate two people. Subhanallah, separate and put our leg, right? Right, we listen to the khutbah really important. And one leg comes in here. It's like, who is this guy, man? Right? So Allah's Messenger says, does not separate two people. How many times we've seen? Subhanallah. Right? Initially, when I used to sit there, I had legs coming right across my face. Allah has given me izzah, I'm red. Right there, now I see people coming in and separating, you know, two people. So Allah's Messenger says, don't separate two people. Meaning, if the row is done, over. Khalas. Just because, okay, I want to sit near the imam. You can't jump and come. Right? We've seen some people. 130 jamaat, 127, they are right here. Right? Subhanallah. And they say, MashaAllah, I've got the reward for the first row. Allah's Messenger says, you don't get anything. Allahu Akbar. That's so dangerous. Don't separate two people. Right? It's a big, big sin. It's a sin that you commit. And don't separate two people. And pray as much as that is written for you. We will come to the sunnah of Jummah. How many rakats to pray and how many rakats to pray after Jummah, inshallah, in session number 3. Session 2 is before the khutbah, right? And then remains quiet and attentively listens, right? Remains quiet and attentively listens to the khutbah and he sits close to the imam. Subhanallah. Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, all his sins from the previous Jummah to this Jummah are forgiven. Subhanallah. All his previous sins from the previous Jummah to this Jummah are forgiven. Let's go back and remember this hadith. Number one, to ghusl, like that of a janaba. So meaning, the bath is included in your great reward. Right? Yes, you can come even without a bath. But you'll end up doing how many things? Four. Your complete sins are not forgiven. Allah's Messenger says, the one who does ghusl, the one who perfumes himself, the one who proceeds to the masjid, does not separate two people, listens attentively, then his previous sins are completely forgiven from till this Jummah, from this Jummah to the other Jummah. So till this, alhamdulillah, so the next session, inshallah, session number 2, we've entered the masjid now. We will talk about coming early and the khutbah and the etiquettes of the masjid. And sisters, since Hikmah allows you to come to the Jummah, you should not miss that class, session number 2. I'll tell you, there was a sahaba who came to the masjid of Allah in the masjid during a Jummah. A sahaba, and he walks out having nothing taken back from the Jummah. Nothing, no reward, subhanAllah. Why? You and I should know the etiquettes of Jummah and what you and I should do. Brothers, if you don't know it, you should attend the session number 2, inshallah. Alright, so with that, alhamdulillah, it's 1:10. I'll leave 5 minutes, 1:15 is the Adhan. I'll leave 5 minutes for question answers on today's topic. Any questions? Sisters, feel free. Brothers, feel free. Sisters, you want to write it down? You can write it down and give it to me.
If the Prophet's body is not
all right.
How is it that Dawud faced the Prophet?
Two days of the week that angels take?
Since you read Dawud throughout the week. But Allah says, Allah has appointed that twice a week they will collect all his dawuds and take it from the Prophet.
I don't think that's right.
That's right. Friday, they are presented to me.
Yes, it's Friday that is presented to me.
So, the what you read throughout the week, it goes to the Prophet on
Friday. Al-Salam on Friday, yes. What you're talking about is Mondays and Thursdays, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, your deeds are presented to Allah, not to Rasulullah. Right? So fast, and Allah's Messenger says, the one who fasts on Mondays and Thursdays, the deeds are presented to Allah of the week, and I love to be in a state of fasting when my deeds are given to Allah. That's the hadith of fasting.
But now Prophet's soul is in the grave.
Yes, 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 absolutely.
So when we go to Masjid al-Nabi and we...
And that's why that's the only place you stand before the grave of Rasulullah and you say, As-salamu alayka ya Rasulullah. That's the only place on earth. Why? Because he's present there. Bangalore, Australia, America, Europe, there's no Ya Rasulullah. That's shirk. Alright?
So that he responds to you directly.
Yes. Why? Again, because the Sahabas did it. Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu went there and said, Ya Rasulullah, Ya Abu Bakr, Ya Umar. So we know they are alive.
The souls of Abu Bakr and Umar also are there?
Yes. Everybody's soul is in the grave, brother. So understand, when you're laid in the grave and when the punishment is happening, your soul is not in commercial street. Your soul is in the grave. Because the body, the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, we believe the punishment of the grave is for the soul and the body. So soul is not watching the PVR cinema. Right? Oh, amazing man. Just bash him up there more. Right? Bash up that head, you know? SubhanAllah. He didn't get up. Just bash him up. The soul is not outside of the body. The soul is a part of the grave. The soul and the body is being tortured.
Okay.
Alright? Jummah questions only. That's it. Khalas. Yes, brothers. Any other questions? Sisters? See, the word barzakh means a barrier. Barzakh means an unseen barrier, a hidden barrier. Life in the grave is barzakh. The life in this dunya, you can see me, I can see you. That's dunya. Next, a transition. You and I are laid, suppose you, I die, I'm laid in the grave. That life that you can't see inside the grave. Can you see inside the grave? You can't. I can't see. That life is unseen. It's a barrier between what? The day of judgment and this life. So barzakh means unseen barrier. It's a transit, that's it. So Yawm al-Qiyamah is the day of judgment when you and I will be resurrected again. So barzakh is an unseen barrier. Best time to read Surah Al-Kahf, if you really want to go by the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the early morning recitation is witnessed, subhanAllah, is witnessed. Allah says in the Quran that when you read early, really early, it's witnessed. And the best time is again, Allah's Messenger has made a dua after Fajr, right? For the time of Fajr is really blessed, after Fajr is really, really blessed. You want to pray it after Fajr? Alhamdulillah.
Perfume is only other or perfume with alcohol?
Debatable, but try to avoid perfumes with alcohol. Right? Because both the scholars have given their views that attar is the best. But today we know from science that when you spray the ethanol or methanol, whatever is there, it evaporates. It evaporates. Even before it touches your shirt, it evaporates. It's only the smell, the perfume that comes in. So based on the ulama, it's ikhtilaf, but fine, no problem. Then the imam should technically tell the people to come in front. The imam should technically tell. Suppose these three rows are empty and everybody's sitting back and people can't come in. Then the imam should stop and tell the people to come in. Come front, and so that they occupy. And it's ilm, it's knowledge of the people coming to the masjid that they take the first row. Because when we do the session number 3, the first row is the greatest reward. Right? Today, unfortunately, people want to rush out. Imam says, Assalamu alaikum. The second salam, this guy is starting the bike. Right? He's starting the bike almost. So that's the problem. People just want to run off, zip off. As people coming to the masjid, you should have masjid etiquette. It's wajib, brother. I'm telling you, it's not sunnah. It's wajib to know the masjid etiquettes. Especially for men. Sisters, it's sunnah. But for men, you have to know. Allah's Rasul, Sahih al-Bukhari, they said, the we used to fight for the first row so much that if Allah's Messenger would have put qurra, lots, we were ready to do it. SubhanAllah. Today, brother, you go. No problem. SubhanAllah. They were ready to put lots, chicks. Whose name? Abu Bakr. Okay, stand first. Umar, stand second. Imagine. They were ready to put chits for the first row. That's how important the first row is. So, the imam can, in fact, so much so, the imam can get down from the Jummah khutbah. It's a beautiful hadith. Allah's Messenger was giving a Jummah khutbah, mimbar. Right? Probably the sisters are looking at this for the first time, probably. Right? This is the mimbar where the imam stands and he sits in between the two khutbah. Rasulullah was giving a khutbah and he saw his grandson Hassan, small kid, coming to the masjid. Rasulullah stopped his khutbah, got down, came walking between the people, hugged him, took him, went back and started giving the khutbah. SubhanAllah. You do this here. Allahu Akbar. You're gone. It's so amazing. The sunnah is present. Allah's Rasul did it. Stop the khutbah for his grandson. And today we don't even allow children coming to the masjid. Allahu Akbar. It's such a shame that we don't have the blessings of Allah. But I'm telling you, the blessing of Allah doesn't come in the masjid of Allah because you and me are there. The blessings come when the children come to the masjid of Allah. I'm telling you, get the children to the masjid of Allah. Whether they wear a Man U shirt or a Chelsea shirt, get them in. Automatically they will remove it afterwards, inshallah. Right? Yes. Last question, when you're done.
Can you just elaborate a little bit about how the regular shower is different from the one that we call Jummah?
Okay, I'll come to that question.
Different imam covering different masjids for Jummah salah. First,
okay, I've not come to the khutbah. Khutbah is session number 2. Right? Hold on. Pause. I'll come to sister's question. Great question. We've already done the fiqh of wudu and ghusl, but I'll repeat that in a nutshell. Your regular ghusl can be, you start from your head, you start from the legs, whatever. You can just put a bucket of water, shampoo, soap, and you walk out. Now, the authentic way of doing ghusl, the Islamic ghusl that Allah's Messenger did, he started washing his hands first, 3 times. Alright? Then he washed his private parts 3 times with his left, never the right. Don't use your right hand for washing your private parts. Left hand, he washed his private parts 3 times. Then he poured water and he did wudu. Except the legs. Legs, he didn't do wudu. Legs, he didn't complete it. He did hands, mouth and nose, face, arms, head and ear. Right? Neck is a bid'ah, so don't do neck. Neck is not there. Not a single hadith can be there in. There are 30,000 hadith, but not one hadith shows neck. So neck is not allowed. Rasulullah never did neck. head, ear, and back of the ear. That's the most authentic hadith. After that, you take your hands, fingers, dip it in water and rub your scalp. This is the sunnah. You rub your scalp and make it wet. Take 3 handfuls of water and pour on your head. Your entire hair should be wet. Then start from your right side. Pour water on your right and then pour water on your left. Then you want to apply soap, shampoo, whatever, right? Face pack, anything you want to apply, you apply. Have a shower, wash yourself, then move from that place, wash your legs, and your wudu is complete. Now you can use that same wudu for the whole day. Except, don't touch your private parts when changing your clothes. That's it. Alright? So that breaks the wudu again. So, the thing is, Rasulullah came out from that place where he had a bath and then washed his legs. That's the sunnah. Right? Hope that answers your question. With that, subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.